Brothers and sisters, this is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Today, let us consider the source of our authority for the prophet in Deuteronomy and in the Gospel of Mark. We see the Hebrew text of our first reading that the words of God in the mouth of the prophet are the source of power. Moses, on his deathbed, prophesied that God would raise up another prophet like himself who would speak on God's behalf. Such prophets have appeared over time and at times when people didn't want to hear them. But Moses' calling and the subsequent prophets would be anchored in the Torah and God's word being made known through the prophet. So let's think for a minute about what is a prophet. It doesn't necessarily mean foretelling the future in some magical way. Someone we consider a prophet is a person who is very sensitive to what is going on around him or her. He or she is able to name the truth in a given situation, whereas others may not see what is happening or might not want to know what's happening. Often prophets were killed then and now. Even today, they may be rejected and there may be negative consequences. A whistleblower in the industry or government, a public official who tells the truth and then is not reelected, a true friend who tries to confront a problem in a relationship at the risk of alienating that other person, a parent who understands their offspring better than the child herself does. We can think of many situations where a prophetic role was involved, and it does always come with a price. In this case, in the Gospel of Mark, the unclean spirit cried out, "I know who you are. You are the Holy One of God." That term was used for prophets such as Elisha in 2 Kings, who foretold the birth of a son for a barren woman, but then later the child died. Elisha breathed on him and touched him with his staff, and he came to life again. Elisha, a prophet and healer, in his time was called the Holy One of God. In today's gospel, Jesus was so designated by the unclean spirit in distress. And so this unclean spirit says, "Are you out to destroy us?" And think to a moment of distress when something is changing emotionally, spiritually. Often we may feel that our whole situation will blow up in our face. It's a very common kind of reaction, and the evil spirit or unclean spirit feared for the Lord intervening with him. We should note that Mark describes the man who just happened to show up in the synagogue as having an unclean spirit rather than a demon, which is used in other places in the book of Mark. In Jewish thinking in that time, unclean spirits were sometimes associated with the fallen angels of heaven. And Jewish believers, as well as pagans, taught that impure spirits had to be cast out, blocked, rebuked, in order that people could live free from forces of fear and evil. Every aspect of life was influenced by these forces and fears. The belief in demon possession must have been rampant and terrifyingly real. Archaeologists have found thousands of skeletons where skulls were surgically trepanned, that is, a hole cut in the skull, to let the evil spirit out. those demons were called Nausicaan, or ones who do harm. And fear was rampant and on the increase when the book of Mark was in the process of being written. It was around the time during or after the destruction of the temple, the center for spiritual authority for the Jews. Civil and religious authorities clashed, with Rome winning and the temple destroyed. Everything was turning upside down. There was an urgency. Does that sound familiar to anyone today? History seems to recycle and repeat, and perhaps humankind requires a repeated message from the Lord. We too have our own demons, be they metaphorical, redefined, or literally. And we are in a time where Mark's gospel can awaken us to God's message then and now. More than any other gospel writer, Mark makes frequent use of the Greek word euthyos, which means immediately, at once, and now, directly, straight away. Mark, who was the earliest gospel writer, used that term 17 times, while Matthew used it only 6 times, Luke 3 times, and John once. Perhaps this is a window into the level of chaotic conditions and urgency under which Mark was written. Tradition tells us that the writer of the gospel was John Mark, born in Africa and as a young lad in a time of political unrest. He and his mother traveled to Jerusalem and resettled there. In her house, it is believed that the upper room gathering of Jesus and his disciples occurred, and later the Pentecost took place there. It was a safe house to which Peter fled when he left prison. So let us meditate today on the first miracle of Jesus reported by Mark. The gospel repeats healing throughout. It's repeated 13 times from beginning to end. And later in the gospel, the scribes rebuked Jesus, suggesting he could only do this because Beelzebub, the prince of devils, was in him. But the validity of Jesus' power is seen in all of his activities and actions. Some in that day obviously had raised concern about how Jesus had the power to heal. In Mideastern cultures, one could not step outside of one's inherited status. If you were born in an artisan family like Jesus was, it was not expected you would become a rabbi and teach. The listeners in Capernaum, when Jesus entered the synagogue and taught with authority, were astounded, while those back home were upset by his doing the same thing. But not only was it the content of his teaching, but he exhibited unanticipated authority in his teaching. And he was able to bring healing to the man with the unclean spirits. So the afflicted man's honor and identity were restored because he became of one mind rather than a divided mind. We see that teaching and healing are two sides of the same coin. And Mark makes this point repeatedly. Perhaps we have separated these gifts in our own minds, but they were not separate in Jesus' time. We should remember where Jesus began, and his teaching was recognized as authoritative because the gospel says he taught with authority, not like the scribes and Pharisees, who had recognized teaching authority, whereas Jesus was a big surprise. So what was the difference between them? Perhaps the source of Jesus' authority was not only because he knew the scriptures very well and taught them to the people, but they were part and parcel of his entire being. So when he spoke, it was succinct, forthright, and coming from his certainty of his own identity. We are not given the details of what he taught, but we are told that he healed. And the healing incident in today's gospel is actually sandwiched in between two stories about teaching authority. So there is probably some significance in relationship between the two activities for the writer. Perhaps to teach is to facilitate healing, and one who is taught may be healed. We ourselves here at St. Matthew have long known and experienced how good teaching in itself leads to healing, as our Bishop Peter has repeatedly shown us. So what can we learn? There is a difference between authoritative and authoritarian. Jesus was said not to teach as the scribes and Pharisees, whose interpretations were no longer life-giving to their listeners. The power came from God, not from the institutional synagogue hierarchy. Always and forever, human social systems start out as open, flexible, life-giving, and as they become fixed under the control of those who have an investment in keeping things always the same, the life is squeezed out of the teachings. Jesus made the Torah come to life again. And we, if we are to lead, to bring the good news to others, it must be living for us. It must permeate our lives throughout our being. We have to ingest his words, make them part of ourselves. We have to do the word and be the word. We don't have to be perfect. Hopefully, we don't try to present ourselves as people who have everything in our lives solved. We don't have to rely on credentials and recognition, but as those who by their love will be known as his disciples. As we are real, authentic persons in our faith, we will be seen as authoritative. We will mirror Jesus' authenticity. If he lives in us and we allow him to teach us, to guide us as to what people around us actually need from us, and we can participate in his healing of others. In the psalm for today in the lectionary, it reads that we are to be tested. We are put to the proof when others have seen our work. And this is the mark of a follower of Jesus. God, you raise up prophets as in the time of Moses. All around us we could hear them as you put your words into their mouths. Help us listen. Let us be, God of peace. We would love to love you without unrest in us, whatever our state of life or mind, freed from anxieties. Lord, give us this day and every day peaceful hearts. Amaze us, Lord of the universe. Spellbind us with your words. Change us with your word. Leaven our lives with the life of your love. And please, let us take you out to the whole world. Amen. And that is the gospel for today.